Welcome to the all-new SGNP with your host, Daniel Britt, and Southern Gospel Music Association President and gospel music fan favorite, Arthur Rice. Sit back, relax, and get ready to laugh, cry, and have a little fun. If you like what you hear today, please leave that 5-star review, subscribe to wherever you download podcasts, and listen. For back episodes of SGNP with some of your favorite people, go to www.southerngospelnewspodcast.com. What's wrong with living right anyway? Not one thing. And you're listening to SGNP.
Today was the day. Its fight's finally over. It's hard to let go of the hand you've been holding. The same one that picked you right up every time you fell down. Remember, he said, son, I know where I'm going. And because of his faith, there's comfort in knowing that through all the heartaches and tears, you're crying right now. Heaven just got sweeter for you. The one you loved, loved Jesus too. No more suffering or pain. Now he's in that place where all things are new. Even though you're hurting like this, he knows you know where he is. And someday he'll come running when you get there too. Heaven just got sweeter for you.
Good, Jim.
It's natural to feel your heartbreak, but for those who believe that loved ones are away, hold on to God's promise that death is never the end. So when you say goodbye to that old cemetery, for the saint that you've lost, the grave is only temporary. He's already home and he's longing to see you again. Heaven just got sweeter for you. The one you love, love Jesus too. No more suffering or pain. Now he's in that place where all things are new. Even though you're hurting like this, knows you know where he is. And someday he'll come running when you get there too. Heaven just got sweeter for you.
And someday he'll come running when you get there.
Heaven just got sweeter for you.
I love you, Daddy.
Welcome to the Southern Gospel News Podcast. Hey, I'm Daniel Britt with Darren Sutherland and Arthur Rice, and it's good to be
all
back with you guys.
Arthur Rice,
all of famer, I'm telling you. You know, Arthur is moving and shaking with the Hall of Fame. I can't wait to see what is new, what is developing. This is and I listen, Arthur, you are doing a good thing honoring those who have paved the way, and I can't wait to hear the next class that makes its way in.
Well, I appreciate it. We're fixing to start voting next month, first of next month, and so we're excited about that, excited about getting started. We just opened a few weeks ago, and I've had some great crowds come through so far, so we're looking forward to a great year.
Good stuff. Hey, Arthur, I've also noticed, man, you know, I know you're leading music at the church and everything.
Yeah.
Buddy, you've got a abbreviated quartet travel schedule now? I mean, you're down in Alabama the other week. Now you're going to Rabun County up near my mountain house, and it's going to force me to come over and see you, I guess, if you're up there, and then you're going different places. What's up with that?
Well, you know, it's one of those deals I really didn't plan. I booked those like a year ago. And, you know, when you book stuff a year out, you think, oh, yeah, that'd be cool. Let's do that. And then the closer it gets, it's like, man, I got to drive to Alabama. And I got to drive to
Georgia. You was hoping they'd forget.
Yeah, exactly.
Alabama, that.
Exactly. It's funny. You asked Alan, I forgot about the Georgia singing. He called me that day. He said, hey, here's the schedule for Georgia. I said, what about Georgia? So I forgot. I told him I'd be there.
Well, here's what I'm going to do. I'll announce to everybody that you're coming to Marietta and that you're going to be in Marietta, and me and you'll just go to Braves game. And
hey, that sounds like a plan.
That'd be your trip to Marietta. Hey, yes. But we got a great guest on today, Daniel.
And
he's probably made the news for gospel music more than anybody else, and we'll get him after the break. Jeff Chapman. So right now he's not with Gold City yet, but he's going to be with Gold City, and he's with the Kingdom Heirs. So when we introduce him, Daniel, you're the pro here. Do we say Jeff Chapman with the Kingdom Heirs, fixing to go to Gold City? Or do we say Gold City's new bass singer and Kingdom Heirs' current bass singer, Jeff Chapman? How do we introduce him, Daniel?
Soloist of the year.
I guess it depends on when this airs.
That's right.
Well, it's going to air this Friday. Right the day after he takes the job.
Yeah, probably by the time you're listening to this, he's probably going to be stepping on board a bus and embark. And it's going to be good. And so Jeff Chapman, and listen, I don't have to do, here's good grammar, I ain't got to do nothing on his EQ and voice, man. It's going to come through loud and clear for you. And he is up next. Arthur Rice, Darren Sutherland, I'm Daniel Britt, SGNP, is back in just a moment with Jeff Chapman.
All the living's getting ready for the last and final call. Death's fire is all the symbol, and we were chasing the one and all. We're waiting for the dissipation. It could happen any day. Cause in a minute and a half from the eastern sky, we're gonna hear our Savior say, get up, get ready.
Here at the Southern Gospel News Podcast. Welcome back to the main highlight of today. Hey, by the way, check out our Facebook page and see what's happening. Listen to past episodes at southerngospelnewspodcast.com. And we've got a great guest on with us today. This is the highlight of the show. We can sit back and get to know this gentleman a little bit better. His name is Jeff Chapman, and I know you've heard him.
Man, Jeff, you took the gospel music world by storm a couple of weeks ago. And how's a kid from Brunswick, Georgia, end up shocking everybody, leaving what everybody calls one of the great groups of gospel music to go to one of the legacy groups in gospel music, moving from the Kingdom Heirs to Gold City? How's that happen, Jeff?
Well, a lot of prayer. A lot of prayer goes into making that happen. I didn't intend to even do it to begin with, and I was going to help them find them a good bass singer. Of course, me being who I am, I get a lot of phone calls, people looking for bass singers. Yeah. And I talked with Tim and got to talk to him a little bit. And, you know, and while I was talking to him, the Lord kind of impressed me to think about it, you know. And so I filled in with him before the Singing at Sea cruise on Sunday. And then we did the cruise after that. I filled in for him there along with doing the Kingdom Heirs stuff. And was just helping them out. It was fun. I had a good time. And you know, the Lord just impressed. It's amazing how the Lord works, you know. He impressed on my heart to think about it. And I started praying. And I even called my buddy Arthur and kind of talked to him. And said, I'm thinking about something that's on my heart. And I think God's leading me, you know. So, and of course, Arthur, being the friend that he is, he gave me good advice and everything. It was on a Monday night after I had filled in with them for a weekend at the Kingdom Heirs were off. God revealed to me during dinner one night his decision. He wanted me to go, you know, and I said, Lord, is that what you want me to do? And I started crying. People around me thought I was crazy crying at the eating table, you know, but that's when God revealed to me what his plans were for me. And I had to have the courage to go through it and fulfill it, you know. So that's how something like that happens.
Oh, wow.
Jeff, how hard is it going to be on you to go from leaving your bedroom every morning to going to a stage and singing to now getting on a bus every Wednesday or Thursday and not getting back till Sunday afternoon or Monday morning? How big a change is that going to be for you? You've been with the Kingdom Heirs 20 years. I mean, that's a long time, my friend.
Yeah, I know. A little over 20 years. You know, it's of course, we toured some during the 3 months we were off from Dollywood. And I enjoyed those times. I always had a great time touring. Some of the other guys that never toured before didn't like have to do it. But I didn't mind it. It was fun to me. But my years before the Kingdom Heirs and everything was touring. That's something I knew. And now it may take a little bit of getting used to, but anything you're doing for the Lord, you got to learn to like it, whether you like it or not, you know. So.
And one last question, then let Arthur jump in here. How are you going to watch Georgia Bulldog games on the bus with a bunch of Alabama people? Is what I'm trying to
do. Well, that's going to be a toughie right there, but I've got all the apps on my phone to get all that, so hopefully I can do it.
There you go. Arthur, what you got?
Well, Jeff is probably one of the biggest Gold City fans that's ever walked this planet. He's always loved Gold City, and he's as big as Gold City fan as I am a Kingsman fan. Of course, I was fortunate enough to be able to be with my favorite group for a long time. And, you know, this is just a, I think, is a dream come true for him. And Jeff undoubtedly is one of the best bass singers that ever walked this planet.
Oh, you too.
And the only thing with, well, I mean it.
Appreciate it.
You know, he's done an incredible job over the years and just had a great legacy. And I think the best is yet to come for him.
Well, I appreciate that, man. I surely do. Yeah, Gold City was a huge, I was a huge fan of Gold City. The first time I heard Tim Riley on that live Gold City album, Gold City Quartet album that was done in Georgia back in the early 80s, I heard, "Oh, What a Happy Time." I heard Tim Riley nailing those low notes, and I was like, "Oh, my goodness, Mama, who is that?" She said, "That's Tim Riley with Gold City." I said, "You know what? One of these days, I'm going to get to meet him." And I was just a teenage boy back then. I found it all glorious to be able to meet him and learn from him. And he kind of took me under his wing, and I always call him my Jedi master, you know, and I'm just a Padawan, you know. But I was able to, you know, get a lot of learning from him. And it is a dream come true to be able to feel this man's shoes, or at least try to do it.
Hey, Jeff, Tim has a technique, and he talks about getting it up in the mask, and he talks about the green and the yellow and all that. Have you taken that course?
I sure have, and I have taught a bunch of bass singers that same way. He always asked me, he said, "Son, do you know what it's like to put it up in your mask?" I said, "What do you mean?" And so he showed me a couple of crazy techniques that worked, and you can ask Arthur. Every morning I was doing that in the studio.
Yeah.
Everything. Yeah. I mean, the last 20 years, Arthur's heard that. Probably yeah. Drove him crazy, but it was fun. I loved being able to learn it. And that's the technique he used. And I hope and pray I can live on and keep doing it like he taught me.
Hey, well, it was with Jeff and Arthur both here and both sing different parts. Arthur, is there any part of whatever that science is that Tim does for bass singers? Is there anything of that that's transferable to other singers?
Oh, absolutely. Every part.
Okay. Okay.
Every part of it. Yeah. 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 Tim, you know, took lessons from Leroy, and that's what Leroy taught, Leroy Abernathy, and that's what he taught. My sister, a soprano singer, she took from him back in the 50s, and that's exactly what he taught her, exactly the same way, even singing soprano. It's, you know, it's the placement of that, of the tones.
Yeah. Listen, you've got the voice. Obviously, there's, and I'm going to say really nice things here, but I want an honest answer. You've got, if there's anybody who could come in and follow in footsteps in this group, it's you. I mean, so you've got the voice. We've got confidence in you. I hope you've got confidence. But at the end of the day, you're following Tim Riley. Has there ever been a pinch me kind of moment that's like, okay, that's a lot to live up to, no matter how good
well,
you are?
Well, I'll be honest with you. Some people have reminded me of that in the last couple of weeks. You know you're feeling Tim Riley's shoes, don't you? Yeah. I said, you know what? I haven't given it a thought yet, but thank you for bringing it to my attention. I appreciate you very, very much.
Yeah.
I don't know when I appreciate anybody any more than I appreciate you right now. You know,
Jeff, Daniel's being honest, just from a fan's perspective.
Yeah.
When you think of bass singers, modern day bass singers, and especially in the 80s and 90s and early 2000s, Tim Riley is the man. Okay. Now that's taking anything away from great folks like Arthur's cousins and, you know, Ray Dean or anybody like that. But Tim, for whatever reason, was the center point of Gold City, for so to speak. Very similar. We could take other parts. What are the Hoppers going to do if Kim ever steps aside? You follow what I'm saying?
And
I love the Kingsmen. That's one of my favorite groups growing up. Mm-hmm. Hamill's never been replaced, no matter how hard they're doing. I mean, I was thinking the same thing. My man, you're going to take over for Mickey Mantle, so to speak. Has that set in? I mean, does that weigh on you at all?
No, I really, it doesn't weigh on me. You know, I believe that when God sends you somewhere, he's got to give you a vision for where you're going. And that was given to me a few weeks before I made my decision. I had a vision for it, and I wanted to help bring Gold City to that platform level of where they were. And I mean, Gold City is amazing what all they've done in the last 10 years, but to bring it back, to help bring it back to great sound again, is just, I'm just part of four vocals that make it, is going to make it happen. And I believe God has given me that desire and that peace to be able to go forward and do that. I'm looking forward to what God's going to do. Now, if I sit back and go and doubt myself and go, okay, you're going to have to do this. I'm thinking about God's building a church, you know, and I'm going to have to do that march like a mighty army band. I start thinking about that. I'm going, oh my goodness, what have I got myself into? But I believe I can do it. I believe I've got to know how to do it. And I'm just praying that God will continue to bless me.
You know what's neat to me, Daniel and Arthur, about Gold City? In Arthur, we've talked to both Jonathan Wilburn and Mark Trammell about how they transitioned into Gold City. Gold City is one of the few modern era groups, and I say modern era not to disassociate the Statesmen or the Blackwoods or anything like that, but let's just say they're one of the few modern era groups that has went out and, for lack of a better word, took an all-star singer from another group. And Jeff certainly is an all-star singer. And Jeff certainly would have won, if he had been in a traveling group, he'd have won Singing News Fan Award 10 years in a row, just like Arthur would have won for 20 years in a row or whatever. The Kingdom Heirs don't get everybody's vote because they're stuck at Dollywood all the time. But they've got an all-star caliber leaving one group, going to another. That doesn't happen in gospel music like it once done. Because if you think about it, Gold City had Ivan, Brian, Mike, and Tim. Mm-hmm. Well, then all of a sudden they left. They had a few changes here and there. But they bring in all-stars. I mean, all-world stars like Trammell, who George Ounce called the best quartet man ever. Jonathan Wilburn, who's probably unsung one of the strongest voices to ever get involved in gospel music. And I mean, Gaither noticed that the first time the kid sang at the daggum homecoming thing, when he put him on the cover of a Gaither homecoming tape. You know, he impressed him that way. I mean, Jay Parrick, I mean, you're helping rebuild the all-star team, Jeff. Congratulations.
Well, thank you. I'm very honored to be a part of it. I just talked with Danny yesterday and just really looking forward to it, man. And I don't want to seem like, you know, the typical things that are said in gospel music, but I really am. This is very exciting. It's going to put me in a whole different genre of people, you know, for 20 years, Arthur will agree with this. I mean, we sung to our Dollywood crowds, and we probably sung to more people than anybody has, but it wasn't the Singing News Fan Awards voting people. It wasn't the typical people that come to gospel concerts. It was just any normal person out on the streets of Dollywood that's wanting to come in and cool off from a hot sunny day riding rides at Dollywood, you know? So,
yeah.
But it's an awesome experience to have done that for a while. And now I'm looking forward to this new chapter, this new season of my life. And I just praise God for that opportunity.
Jeff, anybody tell you you're crazy?
Yeah. Arthur's told me that a time or two.
No. I mean, did anybody tell you, and you ain't got to name names or, you know, tell me who it was or anything like that.
Unless you want to.
Like Daniel said. But did anybody in gospel music pick up the phone and call you and say, man, what are you doing? You get to sleep in your own bed every night. Now you're going back on the road. Do you realize how hard it is out here? Because it ain't like it was in 1987.
Yeah, I get that quite often from our fan base at Dollywood. And I get it through some of the picking of the guys with the Kingdom Heirs and everything. I can understand that. I mean, going from being able to just roll out of my bed, take a shower, and get ready and run over to Dollywood and do about three or four shows and then come home and fix some supper and enjoy my evening watching Braves play baseball, you know. But, you know, but when you're wanting God to lead your life, and everything. That's where it differs to me. This was something God was in. This had nothing to do with Jeff's decision just to do it. It was something God chose for me to do, and I have to follow suit. I have to follow through with it.
Jeff's exactly right, and it was a hard decision. It's always a tough decision. Same with me, you know, to change something that you've done for so many years. You know, it'd been easy to take the high road and just said, well, I'm just going to, you know, do what I've been doing all this time. But, you know, when you do open yourself up to the Lord and he's got something else for you to do, easiest place to be is in his will and right where right. he wants you. And he fixes all that stuff that the world can't see. And, you know, people ask me all the time, you know, do you miss quartet music? I miss the guys. I miss the camaraderie that we had. But God changes your want to. He changes your attitude about different things. And he takes those desires. He lets you do the desires of your heart, lets you have the desires of your heart. But he can take those things and turn them to good. And so to me, the easiest place to be is right where he wants you.
Yeah.
I'm going to ask all three of you this question right here. And I know I'm talking out of turn, Daniel, and it's your turn, but it just popped up on me. As I talk to the three of you guys standing here or sitting here with me today, all three of you, Daniel, you went from being a vice president of Joy FM to stepping away, following the Lord, and ended up on the biggest radio network in the country in homecoming radio. Jeff, you've given your story today about how you've left and now went to Gold City. You've followed the Lord. Arthur, anybody that's listened to our show over the past year knows how you left being one of the pinnacle gospel music lead singers in America to now being a minister of music at a great church in North Carolina. What would you say to people out there right now? Now, this isn't even gospel music related. This is life related. And say this to me, too, because at 53, I find the waters of my life troubling sometimes and saying, God, what is it? What is it? What do I need to do? What did each of you guys go through to get to that point? And I know this wasn't the topic of conversation when we got on here today, but I just feel like there's somebody, and Arthur, we've had moments like this in the past where we just feel like we need to tell people, listen, what do you think?
Yeah, for me, I think when God puts a change in your heart of anywhere you want to be, and I can look back over the course of my whole career, you know, he puts an uneasy feeling in your heart about, you know, where you are. Sometimes you don't know what that is. And what he wants you to do is to seek his face and really draw closer to him so that you can hear that still small voice. And when he's speaking, you know, if the world is so loud around you, if you don't get away from that and draw closer to him, it's hard to hear that voice. He draws you closer to where he wants you to be, to where you can hear exactly what his will is. And really is just submitting to him. Instead of trying to figure it out on your own, he works the details out. He is a great detail sorter. If we'll just leave it in his hands and let him do that, he works all that out for us.
Daniel, I'll keep mine simple and say I agree with what Arthur said. I think deep down inside, it's an easy decision. Now, some of the details could get a little complicated, but the Lord works them out.
Yeah.
But I will say, for years, I had a pretty easy life and went on the radio talking about faith in God. Have faith, have faith, have faith. And I said this a lot back then when I made that decision. I said, this is the opportunity. I feel like the Lord's letting me step out in faith and practice what I've been preaching, you know.
Exactly. So,
yeah. Yeah, Jeff?
Prayer. A lot of prayer. Now, I might get a little emotional about this, but I don't know where I would be if I didn't have prayer in my life. This whole decision was talking to the Lord and what he wanted me to do. I just wanted his will to be done, not mine. And just like you said, it's submission to the Lord and doing exactly what he wants you to do. This was something if you'd asked me up to the very moment that God answered my prayer. Two minutes before it, I was like, I have no idea. I don't know what to do. Lord, yeah. Show me. I don't know where to go, what to do. And even when I talked to Arthur just a week or so before that, I was like, I'll be honest, I don't know what to do. Mm-hmm. I don't know what to do. Mm-hmm. And that's why I called Arthur to get some advice, because it was weighing on my heart. It was weighing on my heart. And that evening, sitting there, I was talking about the guys and the different guys in the Kingdom Heirs and how much I loved them. I was telling about Arthur and Chris and Lauren. And I got down to Andy and Dennis, which are very close friends. Mm-hmm. And the Lord spoke to my heart and he said, you're going to miss them. And it hit me like a ton of bricks. I said, Lord, are you telling me something? Mm. I said, am I going to be the new bass singer for Gold City? And I had the sweetest peace come over me. And I just put my head in my hands with a paper towel and just started crying. Well, the friends that I was there with gathered, and they were like, are you okay? What's wrong? What's wrong? I said, I just got confirmation on something.
Wow.
This is wild. And I had to sit there and just try to explain to them what I was going through. And as soon as I said, I'm going to be Gold City's new bass singer, my son grabbed me. And the people that were sitting across from me, they grabbed me and started hugging me. And I sat there and cried. Because I was like, wow, wow. And all it was an earnest prayer talking to the Lord that delivered that message to me for something that I needed to hear and I needed to know, because before that I had no clue. Mm-hmm. And that's how I see it. And that's the way I understand it, that talking to the Lord one-on-one is the answer for any prayer, anything in your life. That's the bottom line. You've heard Jack Hess with the Statesman saying prayer is the key to heaven. Prayer is the key to anything in your life.
Yeah.
That's my answer.
Wow.
Mm. Awesome. Jeff, let me ask you this right here. And this is the last question I'll ask you about this. You and I are roughly the same age. You know, when you start getting your early 50s, you start looking at life a little bit different because you realize retirement or slowing down is coming down in time and this, that, and other. And if I make a move, it's, you know, it could be scary because, you know, things are change is hard and the world is changing. So, I mean, did that scare you at all? Did that part scare you at all?
That does kind of scare me a little bit. And again, thank you for bringing that up to my attention. But a good friend of mine told me, a very good friend of mine that just happens to be in this chat right now.
Yeah. He's older than both of us, by the way, Jeff. So anyway,
he told me, he said, if you quit singing, you'll die. That's one thing I'm not going to do. I don't believe that, that I'm going to quit anytime soon. I've got a lot of years ahead of me and I'm going to continue to sing. And that's really one of the only few things I really know how to do. I mean, there's other things. I buy and sell stuff. I mean, I've sold cars. The Lord's blessed. In 2020, me and a friend of mine, we sold over 36 cars. In 2021, I couldn't sell nothing. It's amazing how things change. And now I've sold Meyer speakers and stuff like that, PA equipment, doing that a little bit here and there. But you know, that question did come up in my mind, and I just want to, if I'm following the Lord, completely, I don't think I have anything to fear or worry about. So, yes, that question did come up, but the Lord crushed it real quick.
You and Phil Collinsworth need to get together on this car business. You know, he's a big used car sale guy too, you know.
Oh, yeah. Well, I kind of bypassed that. That was 2020, so I tried it in 2021. Didn't succeed very well, but I moved on to different things, you know.
Cool stuff. Hey, Daniel.
Yeah.
Let's change it up a little bit.
All right.
Arthur mentioned, you mentioned the Hall of Fame. You know, that voting's coming up. And you know me, I like to poke a bear. And I'm not going to put Arthur on the spot here, but because he's the president of the Southern Gospel Music Association.
That's a first.
I'm not going to put Arthur on the spot here. Because you're the one. But, Daniel, who would you like to see go in there?
Well, because I don't know all the rules and the ins and outs, and this is just totally hypothetical. I don't think he's in there yet, but and y'all are going to laugh. What about Andy Griffith?
You know what? He won the Grammy for Best Gospel Album on the only album he ever cut, Arthur. What about that?
Remember,
Arthur, back in 88, 89,
yeah,
during the Braves game, Andy Griffith would come on right after what was that guy that played Zamfir? It played the pan flute. Or, you know, you remember those days, Jeff, when Andy Griffith had the gospel album?
Yes, I do. I sure do.
Yeah. Well, even back during the show, I mean, there was, you know, back in the day, in the black and white TV day, I mean, there was music that was gospel in that show.
If the WWE can put Snoop Dogg Dog in the Wrestling Hall of Fame, we can put Andy Griffith in the Gospel Music Hall of Fame. What do you think, Arthur? Jeff, who you got? Who would you throw in there? I know you got a lot of friends, and I know you wouldn't want to hurt nobody, but what name comes to mind in all seriousness?
I mean, to me, I know in the 80s and early 90s, I mean, I know there was some controversy there, but I think Michael English deserves it, to be honest.
Yeah, I like that.
He had a huge impact on a lot of people. I was a bass singer, and I was the biggest Michael English nut there was, you know. But I think he had a lot of impact on a lot of people in gospel music. Another one's Ivan Parker. I think he had a huge impact on singers in gospel music. And I've mentioned this one before, but I don't know if Arthur agree. There's one bass singer that had a huge impact in the 50s and everything on Southern gospel music, because there was a lot of songs done by this bass singer, Jimmy Jones.
Yep. Yes.
You know what? I was going to bring up Jimmy after you talked to Michael English. Jimmy was a good friend to me, Jeff, and I asked Jimmy one time, if you remember, after English went through his public relations nightmare, let's just leave it at that, and Gaither brought him back to the homecoming concert, I said, Jimmy, did you know that Bill was going to set Michael next to you? He said, Bill came up to me before the taping and said, Jimmy, I'm going to sit him next to you because you're a friend to everybody. And
Jimmy
Jones, Daniel, you remember back in the day, and we're talking 25 years ago in the radio business, Jeff and Arthur, Jimmy Jones used to come up to the radio station, him and Charles Keyes.
Yeah.
And Jimmy, I'll tell y'all, this is funny. Charles would say about anything and tell you any story you wanted to know. And Jimmy would say, you might want to hush. That's backstage talk.
Yes. He had this really sweet little chuckle, this little laugh he'd give. But he wouldn't go down that road too far. I have great, great memories sitting in the back of Eva May's Cadillac with me and Jimmy, and then Eva May in the front seat, and then the stories. Oh, they were good. Yes, I love Jimmy Jones.
Well, my thing is, the Jimmy Jones I'm actually talking about, it was with the Harmonizing Four.
There's another one. That's right.
Yeah. I mean, we've heard rumors over the years and everything like that. I don't know. But I know at that time in the 50s and 60s, that man had a huge, the Harmonizing Four had a huge impact on what Southern Gospel Quartet sung.
Yes.
He would actually sing them before these groups would come out with it in Southern Gospel music, and like Father Alone, stuff like that. I mean, it just, Gotcha. She's got City release back a few years back. Tim doing Father Alone, you know.
No doubt, no doubt.
I'm going to say this one first, and I've said this one for 5 years. Kelly Nealon. Okay. Mm-hmm. Kelly Nealon Clark, number one of all women in gospel music.
Yep.
I mean, I'll just leave it at that. That's number one. Yep. Okay.
Yeah. She's a sweetheart.
Number two, and I know some people don't agree with me on this, but Dwayne Allen.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Dwayne Allen has sung gospel music in front of more people, and even though they're not a full-time gospel group, but have sung a gospel song in front of more people than anybody in the history of gospel music. And there's not a person that loves gospel music more than Dwayne Allen, right, and knows the history of gospel music more than Dwayne Allen. So, and besides,
I'm going to say this. I don't know if y'all keep it on here or not, but I'm going to say this. I got to meet Dwayne Allen this past year.
Yeah.
And I found out that they were going to be in town at the Country Tonight Theater.
Yeah.
And so I got in touch with some friends of mine. Aaron McCune was one of them. And he had filled in for Gold City or for the Oak Ridge Boys a few times.
Mm-hmm.
And he put me in touch with the road manager. And so I was able to get tickets, backstage passes and everything. He said, and by the way, Dwayne wants you to come backstage so he can be formally introduced to you and everything. I said, oh, cool. So before the concert, I was able to go back. He started, it was an honor to meet him and Richard that night. And they stood around and talked. I got pictures with him, but he's there. He said he was a fan of me. This is coming from Dwayne.
Yeah.
He said, I was a fan of you when you were with the Anchorman.
Wow.
That's cool.
I said, really? He said, man, I follow gospel music. I know everybody in it. He said, I listen to every group. He said, I love Southern gospel music. I love it better than country. I just love it. And yet, like you said, you won't find a bigger fan than Dwayne Allen.
Yeah.
He's amazing.
Nice.
I'll name two more very, very quickly. And I'm going to tell you. Jeanette Cook, okay, of the Singing Cooks.
Yep.
She goes in to represent every independent out there that's ever sung gospel music. Because Arthur knows this, and Jeff, you know this. They put more money in their pocket being independent than any group in the history of gospel music, okay? and she loves the Lord, and we know she loves the Lord.
Yep.
And just a great Arthur, we need to get her on the show. What do you think?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
And then the last one I'll throw out there is Jeff Steele. I mean, in the 80s and 90s, some of the greatest songs and – you know what? He's bringing the Steels back right now. I know we had his son on a couple of weeks ago, but you can't tell me he didn't write that new song, 100 Altars, that's out right now. So anyway.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the Steels. And back to Jeanette, you know, she's making the comeback in a whole new genre of worship, you know?
She's in that praise and worship stuff. I mean, now us Southern gospel people can go to a contemporary church and sing Ain't No Grave Gonna Hold My Body Down. Arthur, you leading your choir in that one yet?
Not yet, but we're working on it.
I bet she loves that. I bet she gets in checks and she says, I don't know what them newfangled people are singing about, but I'm sure blessed that they're singing that when she gets that check. What do you think?
In defense of the Hall of Fame process, Arthur, you correct me if I'm wrong. You know, some people want to say, well, there's conspiracy. Why are they not in here? Well, you can only get so many in per year. And so it's just a slow process of, you know, eventually getting those who deserve to be in there. I think that's part of it.
Yeah, there is. You know, we're limited to we're going to have a catch up year where there's a lot of folks that have been overlooked that deserve to go in. And a lot of it is the people that knew who they were are gone.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
You know? And, you know, so a lot of the people coming, they don't know who they are.
Yeah.
And so, you know, they're not getting the votes that they should, and they just didn't go in a timely manner. So we are going to have a catch-up year. To the defense of some of the names that you've mentioned, our music is kind of, our Hall of Fame is really for the people that have devoted their whole life to our music. That's where they make their living. That's where they, you know, and so a lot of these, some of these, yes, they have made an impact, but is this where their life was spent?
Yeah.
Gotcha. You know?
And so in defense of some of that, now we have implemented the James D. Vaughan Award again, which we started doing several years ago, and then we got away from it. We've kind of come back to that, and it's the James D. Vaughan Maurice Templeton Award now. We changed that last year because Maurice has done so much for our industry that will pick up some of these folks that, you know, that have had a tremendous impact in our industry that need to be recognized in that manner. But they didn't, their life work wasn't in Southern gospel music.
Makes sense.
So that's
I get where you're coming from now, Arthur. I understand that now. Yep. I mean, and I understand it completely, because the Southern Gospel Music Association is about current and past people that have devoted their lives to it. I understand it now.
Yeah,
I do.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, it's like Elvis Presley, you know, every year Elvis gets numerous votes. And of course, you know, Elvis, this only Grammy ever won was for his gospel album.
Right.
And,
right.
You know, he, you know, undoubtedly sang, you know, How Great Thou Art to more people than probably anybody. And so he needs to be recognized for that, but he didn't live, you know, his life's work was not in Southern gospel music. So, well, I'm going to vote for Elvis before I'm going to vote for Jeff Chapman or for Karen Peck or for Kelly Nealon.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I can't do that.
Right.
You know what I mean? So that's kind of our point with that. I can't say, well, he's more deserving than Kelly Nealon. Kelly needs to go in there before he does, you know.
And then there's, like you said, there's folks that many of us have forgot. Jackie Marshall's of the world.
Yeah.
Bob Cruise's of the world. People like that.
Yep. Exactly.
Calvin Newton.
I get it.
Yeah.
Thank you for clearing that up, Arthur. Yeah. Sometimes I get on the bandwagon and need to hush. But you're exactly right.
Yeah, that's – yeah, I understand the standard now. I mean, so in order for me to get in there, I just need to do this till the day I die. That right, Arthur?
That's exactly. The only way most men get in, Jeff, by the way, is dying. You realize that?
I know.
I told Buddy Burton the other day on Facebook, Arthur, I said, Buddy, don't worry. If you don't make it in alive, you'll make it in dead, I'm pretty sure.
So. Well, see, there's another one that should go in. That go in. Burton, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Hey, Jeff, you're from Georgia. I'm from Georgia. Darren from Georgia. Where are you living these days? And are you going to move, or are you going to commute?
Well, I am from Brunswick, Georgia. I was born and raised there. I currently live in Sevierville, Tennessee. I'm only just a few miles away from Arthur.
Yeah.
But I'm going to stay here for a little while and see how it goes. And I've got a contract that I have to stay with for at least 6 months. So we'll see how it goes. I'm liable to say, you know what? I'm tired of driving. I'm just going to live there. You know, so for right now, I'm going to stay here and drive back and forth every week.
Yeah. Well, if you ever do move, you could go down to the western line of Georgia and still and dip your toe in, still have some Georgia, you know, flashback moments.
I kind of thought about Dalton and Chattanooga area.
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
You know, just be able to touch my foot in the soul of Georgia, you know.
That's right.
That's it. Well, guys, I appreciate this show today, okay? I appreciate the candor that Jeff showed in telling folks how the Lord's led him. I appreciate you guys telling your story on how the Lord's led you to do what you do. And I just appreciate the friendships that we've all developed, Arthur, over time, and how once a month we come together, Daniel, and we never know what we're going to get when we come.
That's, I mean, true.
Y'all seen how much planning we did before this thing was started, didn't you, Jeff?
Yeah.
We sent you a text. You want to be on the show? Yeah. What day are we going to do it? It took us a week to figure that out, you know.
Exactly. See if 3 o'clock on Tuesday would work.
Can you imagine how long it took us if we was going to plan something?
That's right.
Exactly. We've been here 2 months. It's getting figured out, right?
Well, you have been listening to the Southern Gospel News podcast. You got to tell your friends about this because you hear things here that you don't get anywhere else. And we have enjoyed having Jeff Chapman with us. So, Arthur, Darren, it has been fun once again. I'll continue to remind folks, check out our website. Check out the Facebook group. That's at SouthernGospelNewsPodcast.com. And to stay in touch, we've got more coming down the pike real soon.
Arthur, one last thing before we get out of here. What's wrong with living right anyway?
Not one thing.
We'll see y'all next month. Have a good one.
You have been listening to SGNP. Please leave a review, tell your friends and neighbors about our show, and leave that 5-star review. SGNP is currently ranked as one of the top gospel music podcasts globally by Feedspot.com. SGNP is produced by BG Ad Group and BG Podcast Network of Marietta, Georgia. For more information or production help on your podcast, call them at 770-874-3200.